Good evening. This is the regular meeting number 12 of the 98-99 year of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. It's Wednesday, March 10th, for all of you people that watch this on TV about a week from now. Madam Clerk, if you have the roll call.
Certainly. Chairman Groth?
Here.
Councilor Barry?
Present.
Councilor Carson?
Here.
Councilor Fritz?
Here.
Councilor McGinty?
Here.
Councilor Reed?
Here.
Councilor Watson?
Here.
Representative Martin?
Here.
The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any citizen that wishes to discuss a matter that is not on the agenda tonight? Hearing none, we'll move right along. We have a few presentations tonight. And if Andy Strout would meet me at the podium, I'd appreciate it.
That's great.
You're an old hand at being up here.
Record 126 and one.
126 and one. Yeah.
We won't talk about the one.
The one.
Okay.
It's resolution time. Cape Elizabeth Town Council has formulated this resolution. Whereas Andrew Strout, a teacher at Cape Elizabeth Middle School and a resident of the town of Cape Elizabeth, has been recently named the National Girls Tennis Coach of the Year, and whereas Coach Strout's leadership has enabled the Cape Elizabeth girls tennis teams to win the state championship during every year of this decade, and whereas Andy Strout's honor is from the National Federation of Interscholastic Coaches Association, an organization that through its coaches' code of ethics upholds the highest standards of ethical and moral conduct, and whereas, as coach of our girls' tennis program, Mr. Strout has brought much enjoyment and pride to dozens of student athletes as he has led his team to victories. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate Coach Andy Strout on being named the National Federation of Interscholastic Coaches Association Coach of the Year for girls' tennis, and we wish him and his team another great season of success in 1999. Stated this 10th day of March and signed by all the members of the town council. And this is really a good time for me to give you this.
Oh, thank you. But I want to thank the council very, very much. This is truly an honor to stand up here in front of you. Being a resident of Cape Elizabeth and growing up here and playing tennis in high school here and then now being able to serve the community as a coach and doing something that I truly love is a true honor to me. Receiving something like this on behalf of all the kids that I have worked with, both the men and the women of the tennis teams, and especially right now the women with this honor here, I've been very, very blessed to have some of the most talented kids, and that makes it a lot easier for me. And that really comes down to the commitment that the parents have made to these kids' success. And obviously that comes right back to the community and the success that you allow us to have here also. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Andy. Now we have another town council resolution concerning hose company number 2. And I think we have a few people, and how many people are coming up?
All of them.
Everybody.
Everybody. Come on up. Come on up. Come on. Just find a place where the TV camera can catch you, that's all. Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution. Whereas Cape Elizabeth Hose Company No. 2 was formed on March 17, 1924, as a volunteer fire company with 20 charter members under the leadership of Captain Herbert L. Jordan, and whereas from the company's earliest days with a Ford Motor Company Model T chassis to today's use of the most modern fire equipment, the volunteers of Engine 2 Company have responded to every call for fire service in and around the center of Cape Elizabeth. And whereas Hose Company No. 2 distinguished itself with an active fire department band in the 1920s and the 1930s, with a strong ladies' auxiliary throughout the years, as leaders in the creation of the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Unit in the 1950s, and in developing the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department Relief Association and the Fire Department Scholarship Program. And whereas the Hose Company has always been one of the leading organizations in the community in fostering fellowship, in educating our youth with fire prevention skills, in honoring our forebears at Memorial Day festivals, and in helping families with emergencies, both fire and non-fire related. And whereas Hose Company No. 2 has an exceptional record in its primary mission of extinguishing fires with a minimal amount of property damage and in providing for the safety of citizens in harm's way. And whereas the Cape Elizabeth Town Council desires to honor all those members, past and present, who have served in Engine Hose Company No. 2 since 1924. Now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Hose Company No. 2 on the occasion of its 75th anniversary of service to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. And in order to commemorate the first 75 years of service, we hereby commission the creation of suitable display cases to be placed in the fire station in order to preserve the heritage of service of Hose Company No. 2. Dated this 17th day of March in the year 1999, Cape Elizabeth, Maine, signed by all the town councilors. Thank you on behalf of everybody in our community. We have another honor to be bestowed upon Hose Company No. 2 today, and that Senator Jane Amrow is here. The senator doesn't make it to the humble town council chambers very much anymore, but come on up, Senator. And
it's all yours.
Thank you very much. Well, I want to second the town council's recognition of Andy Strout. You know, I had plenty of time to come forward with a sentiment from the legislature for Hose Company No. 2, because after all, they've been around for 75 years. But as you all know, the legislature is a very deliberative body, and we don't respond as quickly to recognitions that, such as what Andy Strout has received. However, you have probably all recognized over the years that the state budget has been going up on an annual basis. And I must say, because the town of Cape Elizabeth has so many outstanding people, and over the years we have recognized many of them, our winning teams, our winning coaches, our great volunteers, that, you know, producing these sentiments does cost money, and people always point to me, "You're back again from Cape Elizabeth with another award?" And I say, "Yeah, but you know what? That's what makes our town so great, because we have people in this community who are willing to give up time from their own lives to serve their community." And that's why I'm so thrilled to be here tonight to recognize the 75 years of service that generations of families in our community have served on Hose Company No. 2. And on a personal basis, I'm really pleased to be here, because on two occasions, Hose Company No. 2 has come to my rescue. One time when my field was on fire, and another time when my truck was on fire. So I really appreciate personally all of the service that they have given. And I have great admiration and respect for the men and women who have been willing to put in their time and who have served over this long period of time. And let me read for you this sentiment from the Maine legislature. Be it known to all that we, the members of the Senate and House of Representatives, join in recognizing Engine Hose Company No. 2 of Cape Elizabeth on the 75th anniversary of service to the community. We acknowledge the exceptional dedication of the men and women of Engine Hose Company No. 2 over the years, and we extend our congratulations and best wishes on this special occasion. And be it ordered that this official expression of sentiment be sent forthwith on behalf of the legislature and the people of the state of Maine, and it's signed by the President of the Senate, the Speaker of the House, and the sentiment was sponsored by myself and our two Cape Elizabeth representatives, Gene Gidmarvin and Peter Chinchet. And congratulations.
Thank you. Come on, Jerry. You got to speak. You got to speak, Jerry. Go ahead, Jerry. You got to speak. I'm only looking at them.
Yes, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for this great honor. It's kind of emotional and a pride that I take this time to say this because 40 years I've lived on this fire company of the 75 years, and I'm pretty darn proud of it. And I think it's, as a chairman of the committee, just redoing the history has been something that has just been overwhelming for me, and it's, I thank you very much.
Madam Clerk, I believe you have a few words about the upcoming election.
Yes, I do. Thank you very much. Just a reminder to residents that nomination papers for Town Council and School Board are now available in my office. The deadline is Monday, March 22nd at 5 p.m. We have two seats available on the Town Council and two seats available on the School Board. So anyone interested, I would encourage them to come to my office and to take out papers. We'd be glad to answer any questions. And if I may just take a moment, I need to thank our colleagues in the city of Bangor. This weekend I had the pleasure of attending the National League of Cities Conference with Councillor Watson. I would like to thank the town manager and council for allowing me to participate in this. Last evening, as you know, D.C. got hit and the city was paralyzed with the snowstorm. And our colleagues for the city of Bangor took care of us, Councillor Watson, myself, and former Councillor McLaughlin. And I really need to thank Mayor Baldacci, the city manager, Ed Barrett, and the police chief, Don Winslow. The three of those gentlemen, plus their colleagues, really helped us through what could have been a very difficult time last evening, and I would be remiss if I did not thank them. I hope our colleagues are making their council meeting at 7:30 tonight to Bangor. Last time we saw them, they were in the air somewhere. And I must say that you really haven't experienced D.C. until you have literally dragged your suitcase through 8 inches of snow without gloves, without shoes, at 10 o'clock at night in downtown D.C. And for that, thank you.
I didn't realize you went down there barefoot.
It felt like it in that slop, I'll tell you.
We're going to move on to councilors' reports and correspondence.
Chairman Gropp, I'd like to second everything that Lane said. The city of Bangor has a fine organization, and they've helped us out a great deal. But I also wanted to thank everyone for allowing me to attend this wonderful conference, the National League of Cities Congressional City Conference. And we arrived on Friday, and we're supposed to return last night, but came in late this afternoon. And we had an opportunity to attend many different seminars that dealt with a lot of areas applicable to, you know, our state government and our municipalities, as well as to meet with our Maine congressional delegation. Congressman Baldacci and Allen, as well as Senators Collins and Snow. And those meetings were very beneficial. We had a chance to talk about the Maine Municipal Association's issues that they're taking on for this year. And one of particular interest, I believe, to Cape Elizabeth is trying to bring our congressional delegation up to speed on just the implications of not funding our special education mandate to the extent that was committed by the federal government of 40%. Last year they funded 7%. This year they're anticipating funding 11%. But as we know, as we go into this budget process, special education is a significant part of our budget, and we need the federal government to step forward and to embrace this and to, before they give us any more regulations, to fulfill the commitments for the mandates that they've already given us. And I think our delegation certainly understands that this is a serious need, and we have their commitment to move that forward. Another area that we discussed was the internet tax and the moratorium that's on it for 3 years on internet sales, and how that implicates our main front, street front businesses, and the implications of fairness in terms of all taxation. And that was brought home, as well as asking the federal government to keep their hands off the highway trust and to return all the revenues that are generated from gasoline tax back to the states, which is where they belong. We're dipping into that fund from the states to reduce the federal deficit, which they have now done. And now they have a surplus, and President Clinton would like again to dip into that fund and use some of that money. And we have received commitment from our delegation that they will support, on a bipartisan basis, not allowing the federal government to dip into that fund and to return those funds to the state, which for the state of Maine will mean $6 to $7 million more for highways, interstate commerce kinds of issues. So those are the kinds of things that we dealt with, the issues. It was very beneficial. I learned a great deal, and I want to thank everybody for allowing me to attend.
Councilor Fitz.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to report that a couple of weeks ago I had an opportunity to visit three state-of-the-art recycling facilities in New England. As the Council knows, I'm representing the town on the Regional Waste System Board, and so I serve on their recycling committee and their finance committee. And our regional waste system has quite a few issues that are affecting them. That have to be evaluated, and one of those is that the city of Portland is going to be collecting their trash in a very different way that will provide an incentive for people to recycle much more, so that RWS is going to handle a lot more trash, so we're going to have to develop a much more efficient system of handling recyclables. And they also, all the trash that is not recycled ends up burned in the incinerator and goes into energy, and they will be affected by the deregulation considerably. So it's been a real privilege to serve on that board, and it's a particular interest of mine since it has to do with trash, which is what I really like.
Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, I haven't been to Washington, but I'm on the county budget committee for Cumberland County.
We had snow too, though, Henry.
And we did have a little, and I think the Public Works Department did an excellent job, especially in my neighborhood. But at a county budget meeting recently in the county jail, we met for about 3 or 4 hours. And in talking with the sheriff, I'm pleased to report that he has available some crews from the inmates at the jail who are nonviolent, who can work on some projects, and he is going to be in touch with the town manager to arrange projects. And I think if anybody in the community has some suggestions for what the work crews might do, they earn good time, and it does not cost the Cape Elizabeth town any money at all. It is absorbed by, they get paid in terms of good time or some small budget there at the jail on a county level. And if anybody in the community of Cape Elizabeth has some ideas for projects that they feel a crew of perhaps 8 or 10 people, usually men, there are more men in prison than there are women, then if they could contact the town manager's office and let them know the suggestions, I think that would be helpful. cleaning up various areas. They can work on public buildings. They just can't do any private work on private property, but they can do anything that will aid the municipality. So that's good news. The County Budget Committee consists of 9 representatives. They're a budget advisory committee. They are not a committee that has really any authority. All we can do is meet, review the budget, and make recommendations to the county commissioners. Frankly, I've been a little disappointed with the expenditures. I know that they've said that they have a tax reduction from year to year, but I note from the actual outgo, the money that they're spending at the county level, in 1997, it was $16.5 million. In 1998, the adopted budget went up to $17.8 million. And then the next year, in 1998, it went up to, at the end of it, $18,376,000. The 1999 budget request is now up to $20 million. So in a short period of years, we're going 16, 17, 18, 20. I think it was Sam Rayburn who said a billion here and a billion there, and pretty soon it starts to add up to money. And I hope that there are ways that the county commissioners, working with the department heads, can find ways to economize here. Also, I would note that the district attorney's office has obtained a federal grant for 6 new employees to deal with domestic violence, and have imposed upon the county commissioners the task of finding space without really enough space in the Cumberland County Courthouse to put these people. And the Register of Deeds, Jack Ryan in Portland, is just swamped. If any of you are familiar with the Register of Deeds in Portland, they have a table with the dates of these documents that are just piled up. They have an obligation to keep these documents in good order, and they just don't have the space to do it. So that is approaching crisis proportions, and I think that the budget committee, working with the county commissioners, are going to have to do something very soon to alleviate that. The numbers of documents that the Registry of Deeds in Portland for the whole county is asked to record has increased for the first 2 months of this year by 4,000 documents. That is, it was about 10,400 documents in the first 2 months of 1998, and it's about 14,400 documents in the first 2 months of 1999. With the same space, the same number of employees, and they're just barely making it. So that's part of my report from the County Budget Committee, which is not encouraging. They've got to do something now. As far as the historical committee, we have met. We may need some more time for our historical committee, historical buildings committee. I think most of the community is familiar with the Keeper's House at Two Lights that was much in the news and in the Cape Carrier in recent months. And this has sparked new interest, I think, in the historical location ordinance, and our committee on that is working on that. We will come back to the council in approximately a month. Councilor Fitz has done a lot of work on this with us, and the members of the committee are trying to develop some system of identifying historic properties, excuse me, and promoting an ordinance with the support of the community, and we hope that the community will support the preservation of historic sites within the town. one note I would just make, Mr. Chairman, of a personal. This week I received an anonymous correspondence from a person I don't know, and I am very willing to talk with any member of the Cape Elizabeth community about anything having to do with the council. And I am anxious to serve, but I do not honor anonymous correspondence. It was postmarked in Portland. I don't know who mailed it. I don't know where it was sent or by whom it was sent. But I do not honor anonymous correspondence.
Councilor Berry, I would suggest that I think every member of the town council got that same mailing, and I don't think I would be presumptuous in saying that there is no member of this town council that appreciates receiving material from an anonymous source. That's just not fair, and it's not something that this community has as a tradition, and it's certainly not going to become a tradition with this town council.
And that's the news from here, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Chairman Groff, I just want to make one comment. I met, as you know, we got to know the Bangor people pretty well. They are, have the first preservation ordinance in the state, and they have won awards for their preservation ordinance. I have asked that they forward this information, if you don't already have it, to Michael's office, and they'll be happy to communicate with your committee in whatever way they can.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Appreciate all the help we can get.
Is there any other counselor with a report or? Town manager's report, Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I want to thank Ruth and Deborah for representing the town so well in Washington. When I suggested a few months ago that Deborah go to this conference that I used to attend in the past, I explained to her it's a good time to head down to Washington, D.C., that I had gone 2 years ago and the temperature was 86 degrees.
Not
so
done.
I'm very pleased that she went.
This explains why she didn't have boots.
Second, I think most everyone aware that Chief Pickering has been out since the first of the year with an illness. I'm very pleased to report that he returned to work full time at the beginning of the week. And I also want to use the opportunity to thank Neil Williams, who served as the acting chief. He's the captain of the police department, for doing an exceptional job during the time that Chief Pickering was away. It was a particularly difficult time in that it was the time that departments prepared their budgets. And Captain Williams did an excellent job with that. And, you know, throughout the tenure of the last couple of months, there was really no instance where there was anything that really needed to be dealt with by me in the police department. Captain Williams just did an exceptional job. And I would like to thank him for his help. Second, this is something more for the council, but you're used to seeing George Manolakis, our custodian, at many of the meetings that you're at here in the evening. I'm sorry to report that George is moving to Florida. Apparently doesn't like the snow. I'm not sure either. He knew how far south to go. But he's worked here a number of years as our custodian. He's just done an exceptional job, not only with the job he does, but I think his interaction with everyone that came into the building. And he will be missed. So I'll have a lot more to say later on. On other issues, so I'll leave it at that. But I do really want to thank all the department heads for all the cooperation, particularly with the budget the last couple of months.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve the town council meeting minutes of February 8th, 1999?
I move that the minutes be approved as written.
Moved by Councilor Berry and seconded by Councilor Fritz. All in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Item number 106, this is going to be a public hearing on the proposed master plan for the Gulf Crest property. We've used lots of different terms for this property. This is the land next to the transfer station that we have purchased. Before we have the public hearing, though, I thought it might be helpful if Mr. McGovern could give some brief background so that we can, for those of you at home or even here that really haven't heard about this piece of property, we can fill you in.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think most everyone in the community is aware of the purchase of this property. It's a little bit more than about 110 acres. It does stretch from Spurwink Avenue all the way over towards the rear of the school grounds and almost gets to Fowler Road, but there is in fact no right-of-way for our intended purposes on this property to Fowler Road. The Facilities Committee, Facilities 2000 Committee, chaired by Gilbert Jordan, who is here this evening, has been working hard on this project as well as other Facilities 2000 initiatives, which eventually the plan is to move Public Works to this property, to renovate the Public Works garage into a fire station, and to transition the current police station, public safety building, into a new police station. Steve Harding of Ost Associates, our town engineer, has been working on this project along with Joe Hennessy, an architect in the office. I could either defer to you, Gilly, to say a few words, or to Steve to give an overview of what's proposed.
Before Steve starts, I've said this many times with the Facilities 2000 Committee, but it's a very hard-working committee that's, I believe, has done an excellent job and has been very well supported by our town engineer.
Thank you. I'm Steve Harding. I'm the town engineer. I also work with Ost Associates. We've been working since last summer with the building committee and the council on the Gullcrest master plan, which we have a picture of right here. Basically, let me orient you. The transfer station is up on the top of the sheet. We have Spurwink Avenue running along that. Down to the bottom of the sheet is Fowler Road. There's some residential properties along Fowler Road. There's no part of the Gullcrest parcel that physically touches Fowler Road, though. It's separated from that by the residential areas. There may be a packet also in exhibit in your packet that basically shows the developed area, and this is the upper left-hand portion of that. Basically, the purpose of this, when the town, the council purchased the property, was to serve three needs. One was to provide an area for the public works facility to be constructed and relocated from the town center area. A second need was identified to provide an area to construct some athletic field, which has been identified as a need in some previous studies that the town has undertaken. And the third purpose was to preserve and be able to use some valuable open space area and to create a trail network so that people could enjoy the benefits of the natural surroundings. This area, the open space area, covers about 89 acres, which represents about 79% of the total parcel. There are some existing trails that traverse through there. We're hoping to extend those and make those fit together in a loop system. There's also been a goal established by the Facilities 2000 Building Committee to try to create a trail that would connect this parcel with the high school and the town center parcel, town center area over in this neighborhood, and we're going to try to achieve that goal. The recreational facilities cover about 16.5 acres, which is about 15% of the site. There's proposed to be a paved access drive, which coincides with the existing gravel drive that used to serve the farmhouses in this area. We have a small parking lot area proposed here, which would be for users of the town farm parcel, which is across the street from Spurwink Avenue. We also have some future parking areas and future tennis court areas that have been reserved. That isn't intended to be constructed right off. It's there for the future needs of the town if they decide to go forward with that. We have two athletic fields shown here. The upper one is sized for soccer dimensions. The lower one is a little bit longer, and that's so you could play football on it if you wanted to. We also have a future location here for another field. We think we might be able to fit a field hockey sized field in there. That would probably be one of the more expensive areas. There's some ledge outcrops that would require a lot of earthwork, and that's not intended to go forward immediately. And we have these two fields here, and although we sized them for soccer and football, they're intended to be multi-purpose fields that could be used for lacrosse and other sports. Third use would be the public works facility. The Facilities 2000, before I go on to that, there's also a parking area that's been established for the recreational fields. And it's intended that that would have a grass overflow parking area if the needs exceeded the parking that's been proposed. There's also a seasonal restroom area and a storage facility that's been proposed here too. The third use is the public works facility. The Facilities 2000 Committee felt strongly that that should tie in with the transfer station. So you see the two connections to that transfer station. Access to the site or the public works facility would be through the main transfer station access way. There's a back entrance here, which would be for the public works use only. We have a building for the future public works facility that's surrounded by paved areas We have employee parking and visitor parking provided for. We also have a gravel storage area out here for stockpiling of equipment and materials. We're showing a future sand and salt shed area. Ideally, the existing sand and salt storage pile area is here, and that'd be where you would put a building if you were going to cover it. Excuse me. If for some reason that didn't work out, though, we'd provide an area here where that could be done. There's security fencing shown around the building with gates so that it would have a secured access. There's also gates to be provided to restrict access to the transfer station during off hours, and a gate provided over here in the recreational area to restrict access to that area. I believe that's it. This public works area represents about 7.2 acres, which is about 6.5% of the site area. So that kind of gives you an overview of what we've been talking about.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll open the public hearing at this time. Is there any member of the public that wishes to address any issue relating to the master plan for the Gull Crest property? Please come to the podium and state your name and say and your address.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is Jack Roberts. I live on Fowler Road. Totally in favor of the project. Do have a few comments. The possible third field location should be eliminated from the map, so it's not a problem down the road. That particular area is pure ledge. It stands about 20 to 30 feet above the surrounding terrain, particularly on the lower side. And where it exists currently, it provides a real natural buffer and screen from an adjoining property that is fairly close to that. It would screen both the public works complex and the playing fields. We do need to get some of the trails joined out there. There's a trail currently that goes across private property, and the land is already being heavily used by a number of people. My third recommendation, that before the engineers or other people are finished with their work, is that the town develop some kind of a little logo or marker to go around the perimeter of the property and mark it that, to show where the property boundary is. I had spoken with Bob Malley. I have a number of people coming through my yard. Most of them have permission and whatnot, but a lot of people are coming into the yard and they don't know where they're at. And I was going to put up a sign. The only sign you can find says, no trespassing, or if you're coming on the property, you'll be shot or something. I don't want anything quite that strong. Just a boundary marker so people know where they are going. Other than that, it's a great project. The town has done well in getting this. Steve did not mention that the purchase of this parcel also serves an important function in buffering the transfer station, which had this property been developed, that would have been an issue down the road as far as neighbors then wanting to shut the property down for that use. So there's a fourth reason why the town should be pleased that this came forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there any other member of the public that wishes to speak? Hearing none, the public hearing is closed. Oh, I'm sorry. You got to be quick in this town. Please state your name and your address.
My name's Diane Chevanel. I live at 189 Fowler Road, and we are probably one of the closest abutters to the property. We're up and back next to it, and I'd like to compliment the committee for its hard work. I think they've done a fine job, and selfishly, I'm happy not to see a neighborhood of more homes there. I have one request, and the path, and I don't know if the path is official yet, but I know Jack mowed around what might be a future path, which comes awfully close to our house. And my only concern is the dulcet tones of skimobiles at 11:30 or 12 o'clock at night, which go through there now, come pretty close to where we are. And I know there's no way to totally control where somebody goes on a skimobile, but if there were an official path that people do get accustomed to using, if there would be any way to just move it in a bit, my husband and I would appreciate the better chances at a good night's sleep when people are out there in the middle of the winter. Other than that, we think it's a fine plan. Thank you.
Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, Mrs. Chevanel, I walked out there about a month and a half ago on a somewhat cold day, not too bad. But that trail is too close to the property line, and we do plan to move it closer, away, further away from the property line. It's perfectly fine to do, and no reason at all not to do it. So someday, maybe, you know, I'll give you a call, and we'll try to field place it so we do move it away, so you understand where it's going.
Hi, I'm Tim Thompson, 6 Pine Ridge Road. I'd like to know if that possible location for a future recreational field's not really a possibility, and maybe the we could have a comment on that, if it's really not a possibility or an unreasonable possibility. Is there any other site, any other location where another field could be built? Fields continue to be, actually, fields, gyms. Gyms are almost scarcer than fields for kids today in this town. But fields continue to be an issue. And there's certainly, it's not going to get any better. And if, I know that was one of the major reasons why this purchase was made. If there could be some comment on that, I'd appreciate it.
Let me do that. Let me try to answer that, because I'm on the committee and have spent a lot of time on this plan. I'll step out of being a role as chairman of the town council and talk as a committee member. I think in this town, I probably have some credibility as far as advocating fields. And I've looked at this along with the engineers and along with everyone else on this committee. And this property, realistically, no matter how you do it, can only handle two large fields. I mean, there's just no other place when you keep the original purchase of this property in mind, and that was to have open space. And a lot of the open space is not suitable for fields. I mean, it's wet and it's down, and where it's forested now, and moving public works out there. This is not, for those of you in town that think that the pressure is now off for fields because we have two fields on this property, that's simply not true. But these two fields are better than not having the two fields, and you couple these two fields with the new field that will come online at Fort Williams probably in the fall, and we are in better position than we were. But we certainly, this does not end for all time the need for fields in Cape Elizabeth, and it's something that future town councils are going to have to keep looking at. But Tim, I don't think, in my view, when we looked at this and the cost involved, I think the chances of that field in that location that is reserved right now for a field, and that's why I certainly wasn't, I could go along with that, but I think the chances of there ever being a field there are slim and none. But perhaps our engineer can address that even more firmly.
I just can reiterate what you just said, Councilor Groff. The area is pretty rugged in terrain. It's not impossible to do, but it would be expensive to do. That's why we thought a smaller field might be a little bit easier to for the town to budget for. But again, I just reiterate what Councilor Groff said, and that the likelihood of that happening is probably remote.
But it's a good point, and I certainly, again, don't want people in this town to think that we have those new fields at Gulf Crest Farm, because that's not the end. Is there anybody else? I'll get you next, Matt.
My name's Kenny Moon. I live 490 Spurwink Ave, which is right here. I think I'm the closest resident to this new development. and I would just like to emphasize the need for additional privacy screening along this border here for the for lights, noise, and overall aesthetics. And I was wondering if there is any privacy provisions in the existing plan.
Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, Mr. Moon, it's not shown as part of the master plan, but we have contracted with OST Engineering to do the design of the site, carry it one step forward, particularly as it relates to public works garage. One, this will need to go through planning board site plan review, and you know, we will put buffering along there. And you know, what I'd suggest is as we're doing the design, we'll have the engineer meet with you out there someday to discuss proper buffering, because you know, I agree with you, you are the by far the closest, and you know, particularly with the parking lot there and the traffic going in and out, you do have more impact than anyone. So I think we can probably address most of those issues, and you know, I think it's worthwhile of having a field visit with the engineer to help resolve that. Thank you.
Matt?
Yeah, I was wondering, you talked about the, having the vision of soccer and football fields, and you mentioned them being multi-purpose, and I was wondering
whether that would include more baseball and softball fields. I remember growing up, that's kind of been a problem, especially recently. I was wondering if that's included in the term multi-purpose, or if that's not included there.
Not really. Because of what's the compromise that was reached with the field at Fort Williams, as part of that whole program, Lions Field, that area, was developed, and in fact that field is going to come online this spring. I think May 1st is going to be the dedication, and it's just wonderful. But when we did that field at Lions Field, it was purposely set up so that there is now room at Lions Field for another baseball diamond to go there. The problem, when we studied this issue before, the problem got to be when you tried to combine baseball fields and multi-purpose fields, especially since we now have spring soccer and there got to be a major overlap, it just wasn't going to work. And the real shortage in town, more even than baseball fields, now that the one is online at Lions Field and we have room for another, is open fields for many other sports. And that's why it is not anticipated that there will be softball or baseball of any kind played on these fields. Anything else? Hearing no other comment, I'll close the public hearing. Do any councilors have any comments?
I just had a question here, Mr. Chairman. The smaller field, what are the dimensions of the smaller field?
Just so we're clear, you're not talking about any proposed field, you're talking about the two fields, one being larger than the other.
Right.
My understanding is one is a regulation soccer field, which would also allow for lacrosse and also allow for field hockey. Mm-hmm. The other, because a football field is a little bigger.
Yeah, what are the dimensions of the...
Steve, what's...
We're using right now for this purpose, and we may make these a little wider when we get into it, but we're using 210 by 330 for the soccer field, and we're using 210 by 360 for the football field.
Okay, thank you.
And just so we're all clear, when we say football field, and this committee says football field, there is no... it's just a plan for any contingency. There is no field here reserved for any one particular sport. There's been no decisions made about that, but it seemed to be poor planning if, in fact, in this master plan, we did not allow for all possibilities. But there's certainly, that's all anybody should read into this. Councillor Reed.
I've been quiet all night.
You have?
I had several questions and comments. One, I fully agree with the speaker that if the possibility of that ever becoming a reality is so remote, you stated at tonight's meeting, we ought to delete the reference, because 20 years from now, when people look back, there could be an expectation that we could drum up enough support for another field. So I would suggest that the final plan not even note that. The second thing is I would like the people who have raised the question about an ice hockey ring or an ice rink or something of that nature being on the site, understand that that has also been considered and ruled out because of the topographical nature of the area, right? I just think it's important that people understand that there were things considered that could not fit because of the requirements of the land. The other thing I wanted to ask, has the field hockey and soccer coaches and people who might be using those fields been able to give any input about size or scope of the fields?
Mr. McGovern.
Let me respond to that. We use standard sizes. You know, this isn't the final design. This is only a master plan. It is not the intent of the school department to use these fields for interscholastic purposes.
Okay.
They're looking more for the community activities, the youth activities, the over 30, over 40, over 50 groups. So, you know, they haven't been as fully consulted, other than for them to tell us that they don't plan to have interscholastic activities on these fields.
I just thought in the, since we have so many volunteer hours spent on things, it might just be something we could run through. Also, I just want to say that although this is called the Facilities 2000 study, most people who have been around and many people in this room know that this work started in 1990 and before. So, as Senator Amaro said, although the legislature works deliberately and sometimes slowly, sometimes some of these major decisions take a decade to reach, and I'm very pleased that we've finally come to this point.
We're going to, if I close the public hearing, I'm opened it up again. Go ahead, Andy.
Thank you very much. Andy Stroud, I live on 30 Fowler Road. One of the things that this is absolutely fantastic. I coach soccer at CAPE, and I'm involved in a lot of the different activities. But if you look at a soccer field, a field hockey field, a lacrosse field, there's a certain place on all those fields that gets worn down. Bob Malley knows this very well, that these are the places of the field that they've got to fix all the time. If it's possible, and we could make these fields square, then one year you're playing east, west, the next year you're playing north, south. So that the only area that's getting worn down is in the middle of the field, and because we have to rest so many fields every single year, and there's no field in this town that people can play during the summers, if we could do that, then the maintenance on it would be cut down by quite a bit. I had an opportunity to visit Wimbledon and see how they work their tennis courts over there on the grass. And their courts are longer and wider than any other tennis court because year two, they move the courts to the left a little. And then they move them back a little so where the people are serving isn't always on the same spot. So the people, like on a soccer field, the soccer goal would not be in the same spot each year. You could switch it back and forth, east, west, north, south. Just an idea if there's room to do something like that.
Boy, we have smart people in this town, don't
we? See why I asked the question?
Anyone else? I'm really going to close it for real this time.
That was worth opening.
Just if I might, we did look at that issue. And, you know, I want to give the committee credit for having looked at it. And if you look at those fields, they are rather tight together, particularly with the parking and with the side setbacks. And it was actually, you know, I think they moved them about 25 times during the committee process, even to try to squeeze those two in. So that was looked at by the committee. And unfortunately, because of the topography of the land, the setbacks, and the need to have spectator space, parking lots, and the other accoutrements that go with the field, they weren't able to do that.
Close the public hearing. Any councilors have any other comments?
I'd just like to give Jack Roberts some thanks for some help that he gave the committee. I think, I mean, he has been out there helping map with our town planner, mowing the field so that we could take walks and be able to see the site, and just his basic knowledge of the land is just, I think, been very, very helpful.
Thank you. Yes, we're just not taking any action.
It would be to adopt the master plan in some form, with an amendment or without an amendment.
I have a comment.
Council McGinty.
I'd like to see us leave on the master plan where the proposed field might go. Because having gone through the experience with Fort Williams, where their master plan actually designated where some fields might go, it was helpful to us to know that when people were planning for the master plan for Fort Williams, they had thought that somewhere down the line they might want to put some fields. And I think that if we don't leave it on here, even though, I mean, who knows 20 years from now what technology might be available to build a field there. But by designating that as a proposed area, at least whoever's sitting here 20 years from now will be able to say, well, yeah, they did think that maybe somewhere down the line we could have a field there, as opposed to saying, well, because they didn't designate it as an area, it should be kept, you know, pristine or whatever it is, you know, whatever you want to say, open. So I'd like to see it stay, that designation stay on the map, knowing it's a long shot that it may ever be built.
That was certainly the committee's view when they put the proposed field. They knew it was a long shot, but you never know what's going to happen in the future, and that's why the committee decided to do that for that exact reasoning. Is there a motion at this time to adopt this master plan?
Are we not, just accept it? Are we adopting it as is exactly?
Adopting,
yeah. We need to be on track, we need to keep things moving along. Councilor Reed.
Well, I'll retract my previous comment in favor of Mr. McGinty's, and I will say that I will move that we adopt the master plan proposed for the Gulf Crest property at tonight's public hearing.
Right. Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to propose that the plan, that the motion be amended to reflect moving the path that was close to the Chevenel's property, move that back away from the.
Before we do that, let's hear the town. I'm not so sure that path is on the town, on the master plan as it is. Is it that close?
Yeah, if I could interrupt. I believe Ms. Chevenel came to the meeting, and there is a path, and you can kind of see it faintly on here, and the dark areas are where we're proposing to keep the path, and that did cut over near her property, which is right over here, and we've basically gone away from that and abandoned it and come up through the center more through here. So we recognize her concerns, and that's certainly something that we're trying to show reflect in this plan.
So on this master plan, that particular trail isn't on it. That's my point.
Okay, then that's fine. The other thing I'd like to have shown on there is a buffering along the edge of the fields between that property line.
Well, the problem with that, is that this is a master plan, not the detail. There's tons of detail that isn't on this plan, and I think that's certainly something that's going to have to be addressed when we go to the planning board and move forward in this process. But when we get to that level of detail on this master plan, I mean, we could be here a long, long time. And
well, I'm only making that one proposal. I think buffering a significant active use of that site from the property next door is a significant thing that ought to be on the master plan.
Do you accept the amendment?
I don't. I have a question before I would ever accept it. Isn't that really up to the planning board? And isn't it a site plan issue more than a master plan issue?
If I might, it's up to the planning board as a regulatory matter, but the town council is the custodian of the property on behalf of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. So it's up to you as the property owner to agree to do that in whether or not to include that in an application of the planning board. You know, I just can't imagine the town not buffering that property. It has to be done in order
That's
to
my point,
make
and
this work.
We've made a representation this evening in a public hearing to the abutter that it will be taken care of. And I just don't know if four councillors think it's necessary.
Well, the initial question is, are you accepting the amendment?
No.
Do you want to vote on the amendment? Or do you believe that the...
I'm still proposing the amendment.
All right. Is there a second to the amendment? Hearing none, the amendment fails. We're back to the original motion. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item number 98. This item is action upon a citizen petition requesting a stop sign on Little John Road at an intersection with Robin Hood Road. It was tabled on the February meeting. Is there a motion to bring that back on the table at this time, Mr. Councilor McGinty?
So moved.
A second?
Second it.
Second by Councilor Berry. All in favor? This item is now back before the council. And before we consider this item, Mr. McGovern, if you would address this.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. First of all, I'd like to observe in the audience that our community liaison officer, Paul Gaspar, is sitting next to Paul Phillips, who was one of the lead petitioners. At your last meeting, there was some discomfort on the part of the staff as to the proposal. And through the acting chief of police, I asked Paul Gaspar, the community liaison officer, to meet with Mr. Phillips, and apparently they've had a successful meeting because they're sitting next to each other. And if I could ask Officer Gaspar to briefly update on what the conclusion was of the meetings that he had with Mr. Phillips, that'd be great.
Chairman Groff, could I just make a point? My husband signed this letter, so I need to let the council be aware that my previous residence was 6 Little John Road. Next to 8 Little John Road, right on by the corner of the intersection that they're talking about. So I have some familiarity, but I also have had in the past some very vested interest in this. And I need to let the council be aware that my husband's signature is on here and that I have some opinions about this, and I don't know how the council wants me to treat that.
Let's take that up in a moment.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Manager, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. I appreciate you allowing me to address the council this evening. I'd also like to thank Mr. Phillips and the other residents of Little John for allowing me to come here to speak on behalf. I know what the council might be thinking. Why is the police department becoming so in-depthly involved in a stop sign issue brought forth by petition? And there's a couple of reasons for it, and I'll try to be as brief as possible, because it really, I think, is illustrative of a couple of things. Illustrative of opportunity and illustrative of really a philosophy that I feel personally lies at the core of the position of community officer and also hopefully to be implemented by the department in general, really. And that's really the spirit of partnership in effecting change, because I feel personally and also will tell anybody that would listen or speak with me that really as community members, as citizens, as youth, as police departments, administrators, and so on, the sole responsibility of providing for a safe and responsible community just does not lie alone with your elected officials and your paid staff in your community, and I address the group with that. I feel that that's very important. I'll give you a little background on the situation. You may already know some of it. We've been dealing with the situation down in the Little John area for several months. In fact, it goes back to September, I believe, mid-September, probably even before that, before it's really rose to a level of being reported to the police department. Originally, it was a instance involving one individual in the area that we felt would be best handled by speaking with that individual. It later turned out that really no change had taken place, and we really felt, I'm sure the citizens felt that they were really spinning their wheels and felt that they weren't being heard by the police department in addressing their issues. And really what we did, which rose to the level of such police involvement, is that a dog. Really in the fact that in one instance a complaint was taken where a dog was killed by this individual previously mentioned. And it really rose to the level that if it's a dog today, might not it be a child tomorrow, or might not it be a citizen walking on Shore Road some other day. So really, it rose to the level where we really needed to be involved, wanted to be involved, and wanted to affect change. Again, knowing and applauding the residents of Little John that they were willing to go the extra mile to work with the police department, not have the police department work for them in this situation. They were willing to fill out witness statements, go to court, and assist us in addressing this issue. And normally what had happened was we had done a speed check, and for those of you that do not know what a speed check is, it's an enforcement tool used by the police department in which we really do a survey for a week straight. We have a radio car or a patrol car in the area with a radar device measuring the speeds of vehicles. Now, through the 11th through the 15th of February, we did run a radar detail in that area. The results of that detail was that the average car speed was 24.725 miles per hour, which is technically under the speed limit of a non-posted area, which Little John is, of 25 miles per hour. Now, normally, a route of a police department would say, there is no problem in this area. Opportunity. What can we do to effect change in this situation? Yes, it shows on paper that there is no problem, but we know otherwise. During that detail, of which I also partook of, we rose to the level, and the petition was brought to our attention, which spurred action on behalf of the acting chief, Captain Williams, to involve me in really speaking with the public. Captain Williams and I, in and amongst all his other duties, managed to survey the area ourselves to address the issue of possibly putting a stop sign in. And what we had found was that to warrant a stop sign, the study that we did really found that it would really cause more confusion in the area, and the proposal was to place a stop sign at the intersection of Little John and Robin Hood. And what we had found was to do that and to really affect a positive traffic flow situation would to be installing two stop signs, one facing the traffic coming in from shore and also the one at Little John. Now, you have a road that is really a subdivision of private homes. There is not a lot of traffic in that area, and really to construct a three-way stop at the beginning of such a subdivision is really, in the end run, counterproductive. It would tend to be confusing for new folks coming into the area or visitors. It would also pose a potential problem for folks that have lived in the area for quite some time, as far as really learning after a while that we do have three stop signs, potentials for accidents, and also really potentials for problems with enforcement, because it was my estimation that in three stop signs, we'd be in the area more times than in addressing the speed issue alone. So in sitting down with Mr. and Mrs. Phillips, we actually denoted several other options that we had. I went over the options that we had discovered in the problems and issues with the stop signs, but again, opportunity. Why stop at just saying a stop sign is not going to work for you, and that's really the end of the situation as far as the police department is concerned. What we found is that why not make suggestions to affect change, and in that partnership with the residents, either amend them or really give them the opportunity to direct police services for once. Give them ownership of their community, give them ownership of their neighborhood. And I'll go over several of the items with you. Against the original proposal of a stop sign, we had found that installation of several, or actually four, 25 mile per hour speed signs in and around the Sherwood Forest subdivision, which, for those of you that don't know, the Sherwood subdivision includes Little John, Robin Hood, Loxley, and all the other roads in that subdivision. We found that this would be one of the first and simplest things to do to educate the public as far as that. Signs in a high visibility area so that people could really get the message that we were going to start taking this seriously. The second was notification of all residents in the Sherwood Forest subdivision by letter and, as much as we could, by personal contact with police officers of the changes going on in the neighborhood and our intent to strictly enforce them and to involve them in the process. Third would be an initial speed detail, much like we mentioned before, with the intent on enforcement through warning, because we all know it usually takes about a week or so for folks to acclimate to something new. We know that folks are busy in the morning. 25 miles per hour seems like a very slow speed when you're late for work. But our intent is to be there to actually pull people over, not to give them summonses the first week, but to issue warnings, to say this is the program that we've initiated, that you've initiated as community members, and that we will be enforcing through your help. Third would be, after the initial detail, to do random monthly speed details in that area for a period of not more than 6 months. That's not to say after 6 months that if it was needed that we would not do it. We will not give up on the effort to address this issue, but really in directing police services, 6 months is really the maximum we can allow for that type of enforcement in any one given area, given that we have about 9,500 other residents to serve. Information distributed to residents on importance of reporting crimes, violations, and in being witnesses for the successful prosecution of complaints. Again, this is the illustration that opportunity for change and partnership. We cannot do this alone. And if an officer does not witness speeding, either by sight or by the use of a radar device, it lies solely on the responsibility of the community or citizen witness to fill out a statement and be willing to go to court. We know that's a lot to ask. We know that folks are sometimes hesitant in being witnesses and going to court because it is a small community and we all need to live together. But in the long run, what are we trying to do? We're trying to change the situation where we don't have to worry about a dog one day and a child the next, or a citizen. So that's why we stress the importance of citizen involvement. Fostering a self-governed neighborhood watch, and I place that, for those of you that do not have this, in parentheses, in quotation marks, because there was really no other title by which to put this. Really, policing ourselves is really what it is. If you see folks not adhering to the law, call us. We'd be more than happy to come down and take care of the situation. But being as two officers servicing 9,500 residents in an 8-hour period, we may get to the area of Sherwood Forest once or twice during a shift. So it would be important for you to be involved in that as well. And regular follow-up by myself on monthly basis with residents, normally the key residents in the petition, to see how things are going and how we can make change for better. If something is not working, there's always room for change. This is not etched in stone. This is not a lock. If the enforcement is not working, we'll rise to another level or we'll adapt. And that's basically what we decided on. So instead of one solution of stop signs, we came up with several in addressing this issue. It's something that I feel very proud about, not so much of my involvement, but we really have a community of folks in the Little John area that have risen to the occasion in fostering and nurturing opportunities for change by being solely responsible for the community that they live in. And I commend them on that very highly. I'd be more than happy to stay to answer any questions that you might have. I am unfortunately leaving for Orono right after this presentation to represent the coalition at an AmeriCorps conference. Please feel free to call me at any time if you have any other issues or questions about the community officer position. I'd be more than happy to answer.
Let's stop for a second. Are you telling the town council that the petitioners, you've met with the petitioners, and they have bought into this solution and the town council does not have to take any action now?
I would be more than happy to have Mr. Phillips come in and give his take on the situation, just so that you do not
Mr.
get
Mr. Phillips, why don't you come up? Because I don't want to have votes on things that are unnecessary.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Paul Phillips, 8 Little John Road. After meeting with Mr. Officer Gaspar, I've agreed to withdraw my petition, so I don't believe there is a need to vote on it. And I also want to not take up too much of the council's time, but it's a big problem in our neighborhood, but it doesn't mean anything to anybody else's neighborhood. And I just want to commend the police force in taking the action that they have and coming forward with a solution better than my initial knee-jerk reaction. And I would encourage any neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth to take advantage of the service that the police department is offering. I've had nothing, I can think of nothing but praise for Officer Gaspar and the police department in general since I've circulated petition and put it in. So I'd gladly withdraw it and I look forward to working with the police department.
Thank you very much, and it is gratifying to have citizens and the police department work these things out. And I would, is it then the sense of the council that we can move forward and...
Can we table this?
I don't even think we have to table it. I think the petition's been withdrawn, so that if in fact it was going to come back to us again, there would be come back by another petition.
Fine. So is there no role for the council in establishing speed limit signs?
There's any role for the council at this point in time.
No, speed limit signs, if it's 25 miles per hour, that's the state, so the state mandated speed limit, so there's no council action required.
Fine.
That will be handled through the Chief of Police and the Director of Public Works.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Very much appreciate your effort.
Chairman Graff, I'd just like to thank Officer Gaspar for working with the residents in the Little John Sherwood Forest neighborhood to come to this resolve, and I hope that it will alleviate the problem and that everyone can live peaceably there. So thank you.
Item number 107, receipt of a report from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission regarding the potential for making Fort Williams Park self-sufficient. Mr. McGovern, perhaps you could provide a little background.
This was one of the town council's goals for the year, was to have the Fort Williams Commission look at this. And I think, you know, without saying whether or not I agree or disagree with their conclusions, that's not important. I think they've done a tremendous job putting together a report. And Dan Fisher, the chairman of the commission's here, Paul Phillips, who just spoke, is also a member of the commission, and the others on the committee, I think, really deserve a lot of praise for doing this. It's the intent for you just to acknowledge receipt of this evening, and then for you to have a substantive discussion with the full commission in a more informal setting at an upcoming council workshop. So.
Yeah, I would like Dan to come up, though. Dan, if you... Dan, I'd like to Dan Fisher, and he's the big kahuna.
Can I introduce myself? Yeah. I'm Dan Fisher, 2 Pheasant Hill Road, chair of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission.
And just so the public at home understands that this was a goal of the council to have a better understanding of ways in which the Fort Williams could be self-sufficient in the future. And this committee has worked unbelievably hard, I believe, in giving the town council a well-written report. And I believe it's the intent of the town council at this point in time to receive this report, not really have detailed discussion about it tonight, but have a workshop at our earliest possible time so that we can meet with the drafters of this report and have a more informal discussion and see where we are. Is that your understanding, Dan?
Yep.
All right.
I would like to make a comment if I...
Yeah, absolutely.
Since we're here. I just want everybody to know in the council that every member of the committee, we met at our regular meetings, but we also broke out into committees. Some did research on their own. Every single member of the commission did a tremendous amount of work in bringing forward information and ideas and all of that kind of thing to be able to put together this report. But one person in particular stands out, John Chapman, who was the secretary until December, wrote probably 90% of the text of this, and he went above and beyond the call of duty. And I think that the council should know what the efforts that went into developing the report.
Thank you very much. And this is certainly another one of those occasions, whether you agree with everything in the report or whether you don't, it's certainly an example of why this community works so well, and that's because we have so many great people, talented people, that donate so much time on issues like this. So is there a motion to receive this report?
I so move, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second?
Second. I just had one question while Dan is here. I was just wondering, in the report you said that you were going to be forwarding and doing some more analysis of the group use policy, commercial use, and the picnic shelters, and I'm just wondering what the timing is for those.
Sometime during the course of this calendar year. That's one of our objectives for the year. We put that in there. As we were developing the report, as you can tell, there's a lot in there. And as we were developing it, we were trying to put something together for the group use and commercial use policies in the fort. And it became another project of its own. And we decided that it might be better to be able to present this as it is and let you know that that is a part of what we are going to do for this year, which is... This is kind of like a document that can be an ongoing, we can refer to it several different times, but that's one of the things that we didn't feel like we could put into this report at this time.
Thank you. All in favor of receiving the report? Opposed? Thank you very much, Dan. And if you would take back with you the thanks of the town council to all members of the committee.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Item 108, consideration of a request to refer to the Planning Board proposed amendments to the town center provisions of the zoning ordinance. And Mr. McGovern, if you could address this, provide some background on this issue, please.
For everyone who's not aware, the town center was the subject of a study committee several years ago that was followed by portions of the comprehensive plan, which was then followed by town center provisions within the new zoning ordinance, and the adoption of a comprehensive plan for the town center that was tied into zoning ordinance provisions. Last year, there was a proposal for one of the parcels in the town center, just south and east of the town hall, over there, to put a medical building, and you know, it ended up, we had a petition on it that was signed by a number of signatures, was a vote on it. It was a very awkward time. That proposal seemed to have died off. We now have someone else who has an option of some type on the property, who would like to do a development proposal there. It does involve some proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance. Before the council considers proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance, they usually refer to the Planning Board. You know, I noticed the team that hopes to develop the properties put up a plan here. It's not really the role of the council to review a site plan or to to look at a subdivision. That's more the Planning Board role. Your role is, under the ordinance and under state law, is to develop the ordinance and the rules. I think the one advantage of referring this to the Planning Board is to hopefully give an opportunity for all of the parties involved, the abutters, other interested citizens, the developers, to have a dialogue. Even in the context of possible ordinance amendments on this, because I would hope that, I'm not saying this is right or wrong, but I would hope that there'd really be a good, fair exchange, not only at meetings but also amongst the interested parties, so that we don't get into extended litigation from either party, which could happen, because this is a lot that I think the community has a lot of concern about and a lot of attention to its direction. So anyway, they're here with the plan, but the request is really, that's on your agenda, is not to review the plan, but to refer the ordinance amendments that are proposed to the Planning Board.
Well, before we get into this, I just want to make sure I understand procedurally what the possible options, without commenting on any merits of any kind, what the possible options are for the town council tonight. Obviously, this is on the agenda. Is it position of the town manager that any citizen at any time, as long as it's on the agenda, can bring forward to the town council a request to change or amend the zoning ordinance?
Usually when the custom over the years is when citizens have wanted to amend an ordinance, it's a policy issue, we bring it to the council.
Right.
To answer the balance of your question, the council's options are to say, no, we won't refer it to the Planning Board. It dies immediately. Two, to refer it to the Planning Board, really without comment. Or three, to refer it to the Planning Board with comment. Any other variation of anything in between that. But you could kill it outright, or you could refer it. Or, then there's the options of tabling it and, the rest, for give it some more thought. Can do that as well.
Now, the Planning Board, unless the town council, and let's not take this project, let's take any project, because I don't want to get into specifics. Unless the council authorizes these amendments to go to the Planning Board has no jurisdiction whatsoever to consider any amendments?
No, that's not true. The Planning Board has the right to initiate their own amendments. And they also have the responsibility to review any amendments that are referred to them by the town council. Right. If the town council refers them, the Planning Board is required to hold a public hearing.
Right. So if, in fact, the town council, in this particular case, did nothing. A petitioner would have the right to go to the zoning board, the planning board directly?
They have the right to propose something to the planning board, but if it clearly does not meet the intent of the ordinance, it's virtually dead on arrival. You know, if it's without doubt nonconforming.
Historically, what has been the normal course of action for the town when, in fact, someone has asked for an amendment to a zoning ordinance?
The normal course of action has been to refer to the planning board, but I can't say definitively that that was done 100% of the time, but that's been the normal course of action.
Okay. Before we have any presentation, I just wanted to flush out all the options and what we're doing as a town council, and I don't want to mean to monopolize the conversation. Do any members of the town council have any questions of the town manager about where we are procedurally before we go any further with this item?
Just, if I could say one thing. There is a provision within the ordinance that if they paid $100 and they got so many signatures, you're required to send it to the planning board. They have not gone through that procedure up to this point. But, you know, if they wanted to go through that procedure, they could require it. Generally, at first flush, we don't require it. You know, in the case of when the petition came for the enactment of an ordinance to change the zoning, that was specific. There needed to be $100 paid. There were other issues. In this case, you know, they've really come in formally requesting it. But they, you know, if you said no, we won't refer it, they could come back next month with $100 and a few signatures, and you have to refer it.
Here's my problem before we start. I am not comfortable not having in front of me in a definitive way where I've had a chance to study it prior to this meeting exactly what these proposed amendments are and who's saying what about them. And I'm not going to sit here, unless the other town councilors make me, sit here for an hour and do in a public session what, in my view, should have been laid out long before the public session in written form, where I would have a chance to look at it. And I'm a little frustrated by this whole thing tonight. And for that reason, my personal preference, but perhaps other town councilors have other views, is I would like to just see this tabled and have written materials that I can understand and that don't seem to be shifting and are accurate presented to me, and then I'm more than happy to, if I have some basic understanding of what's being asked, more than happy to then consider it. But I'm not there tonight, and maybe everybody else is but me. Maybe I'm just slow. Now, what's the position of the other councilors?
I guess I don't understand your concern, and maybe I missed it in the discussion, but I'm certainly not prepared to take up items 1 through 4 without the planning board and or the zoning board and or the ordinance committee having a chance to understand what the implications of these four things are. So I don't see it. I'm not offended by them bringing it to me. I just don't understand why we can't send it off to the planning board.
Well, I don't even know what we're sending is my point. We have that letter, but then it seems
to
me we have modifications to that letter. And I don't even know what.
We don't have any modifications.
We got them tonight. When you arrived tonight, there were modifications, and I don't even know what I'm being asked to send.
Oh, I didn't even see these.
You know, that's what annoys me. Councilor Reed.
I served on the Town Center Committee, and we have many people in the audience who are here for this specific reason besides the presenters, and I do think that some time should be spent finding out exactly what it is. I also don't hold members of the public quite to the standard of knowing what the exact process is, because sometimes I don't know what the process is myself. So without wasting either the presenters or the other members of the public's time or the council any further, I do think we ought to have a forum a workshop, whatever, so that there can be a two-way communication on this and not just we talk about something that we see and then we make judgment. So I would like it to be a two-way or a 10-way discussion, if we could, so we know what it is.
What are you suggesting we do tonight?
Nothing.
Put it to either a workshop or a forum, whichever the chairman feels is a more reasonable arena to have the discussion. But I do think we ought to address these issues because they're not going to go away, and we need to really pin down what they are.
Thank you. Other councilors? Councilor McGinn.
I'm just questioning pretty much the same thing. Are we just delaying the inevitable that we're going to have to face this sooner or later? And I guess the process is my only question, is how we deal with this now. Yeah. You're right. I don't understand all this stuff. And I know that if we have the presenters or the developers present their side, I know we're going to want to hear from some other people that are indicating in their letter that they've talked to. And so we're going to have to give them the opportunity, and we could end up having a public hearing here for something that we really don't need to have a public hearing for.
Well, and that's my problem. I'm just a little, once we open up Pandora's box tonight, I don't know where it's going to lead, and I'm just reluctant to do that when I don't have the materials in front of me that I've been able to study and understand. And I'm all for a workshop. I'm all for having written materials prepared that I can look at and then have it at the next meeting. I just don't think it's going to be very productive to spend large amounts of time on this tonight when I'm seeing things for the first time.
I never even saw these two documents until just 2 minutes ago.
That's my point when I came in tonight.
Me too.
You don't have them?
Just if I clarify what the documents are in case people are wondering. There's two letters before the council this evening. One is a letter from Bruce Cogsell, I think signed by him, but from Mr. and Mrs. Cogsell, that responds to an earlier letter that was received from the intended developer. The second is a fax that was received at the close of business on Friday. You see the time at the top, 4 p.m. And that, you know, we really didn't see until Monday. And as is the general practice, we don't usually send something out to the council right before the meeting. We try to get it out because previous council protest, you know, well before the meeting, and it was really came in after the deadline. So that's what's and I think I know the Cogsells have a copy of that, and I'm not too sure how much that's been shared. But what the council has in front of us, Bruce and Phyllis Cogsell's letter, as well as the 4 p.m. fax. Dated February 24th on Friday.
Well, is there any consensus as to how we should operate tonight? Councillor Carson?
Well, I'm not so quick to just say, oh yeah, let's just send it off to the planning board. I really was not the documents.
Well,
the
that's my problem.
Yep. And I don't know yet.
Mr. Chairman, I suggest we take no action.
I'm sorry?
I suggest we take no action on this item. I have not seen this document until 2 minutes ago, as Councillor Carson said, and I noticed that in quickly looking, there is a conflict in perspective here between the parties as far as their correspondence. And well, I think we should, I agree with you, I think we should have more time to look.
Well, then is there a motion to table?
All right, I'll so move.
Well, did you not say that it would be good to, did we talk about workshopping this? And
well, we're not going to workshop it until we have all the written material and we actually understand what's being proposed.
Okay.
And that's my point. And this would give a period of time, if we tabled it, it would give a period of time that everybody, all the parties could submit whatever they wanted to the town council, and we could have it in a package, review it, have an intelligent discussion about it rather than fragmented pieces. And move it along. I agree that we're going to have to address it. I just want to do it in the right way.
Me too.
That's my motion.
So there's a motion to table. Is there a second?
I'll second with a question. Can we table it to a time specific?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Sure.
What and
to the next meeting?
To the next meeting.
Sure. Next regular meeting.
The next regular meeting in the town council.
I can second that.
I don't think there's any discussion on a motion to table is the problem. Mm-hmm. Once it's been moved and seconded. All in favor? Opposed? 6-1 with Councillor Watson opposing. The motion's been tabled to the next meeting. The matter's been tabled. Yep. We'll take a 2-minute break.
No, one's more March 4th, and one's February 24th.
Yeah, March.
Stretch break. Item 109, receipt of the proposed municipal budget for fiscal year 2000. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, if the council would bear with me, I would like to spend a couple of minutes on this, and I'll try to be as brief as possible. The municipal budget, this is for the budget 2000, for the new fiscal year that begins July 1. I really want to express appreciation to all the department heads for their work on this, all of the town employees, the members of the town council, the members of the county budget advisory committee representing the town of Cape Elizabeth, as well as all the different citizen committees. When you look at this, it's really a product of, well, it's the manager's presented budget, it's a product of a lot of people. And, you know, particularly some of the good stuff in it, and why it's somewhat restrained is an example of the work of a lot of folks. The ongoing municipal budget, if we weren't doing any of this Facilities 2000 material, if we weren't taking over the pool from the school department and paying for the debt, the ongoing budget would have decreased. The tax rate would have decreased. Nonetheless, we are taking over the swimming pool, which has an impact on the budget. We are trying to move forward with this Facilities 2000. The proposal of this budget is for a 28-cent tax increase. If you look at the total tax rate of $19.72, that is a 1.4% increase. Of that increase, as I mentioned, it is totally for the pool operating cost and totally for the pool debt service and for 88% of the debt service to develop the current cost estimate of everything you see on that plan. So, you know, people look at these plans and how it's going to be paid for. This would be paid for by the citizen-approved pool referendum, which my recollection is it was said the taxes would increase 20 cents. So we're able to do all of the pool operating as well as the debt service and 88% of what you see there for 28-cent tax increase. And that's as a result of the county budget share going down. It's as a result of Main Street retirement costs going down. It's a result of restraint in all the different budgets. And particularly, it's a result of the other towns' revenues being good. People are still buying expensive four-wheel drive vehicles. there's a lot of folks are buying new cars. And, you know, while they certainly feel a bite when they come into the office, the good news is that money does go to reduce the amount that would otherwise be needed from property tax. The spending increase, excluding the pool and excluding this, is 2.4%. However, the revenues are up about 8% and non-property tax. So that's why the tax rate would have decreased about 15 cents per thousand if it wasn't for these things. This does include even the decrease included the full debt service cost for buying this property. So we were able to buy this property last year by unanimous vote of the town council. And if we weren't developing it and we weren't taking up the pool, despite buying this, you still would have had a tax decrease. So, you know, it's really amazing, and I think it shows the fortitude, the intelligence of the town council moving forward with it. It was a good time to do it. Beyond that, the capital portion of the budget is $690,000. That's part of the ongoing budget. half of that is simply to take care of roads and drainage. One of the most expensive projects here is a long, long awaited drainage improvement on Shore Road by Tide's Edge Road, where Shore Road floods over and all the neighborhoods there too. We're also going to replace a loader if this budget was approved, pave a lot of different roads, continue siding of the outside of the town hall where the aluminum siding is falling off, new police cruisers, replacement police cruisers, important fire breathing equipment so our volunteers are safe, some communication system improvements, keeping the tennis courts up, taking over the maintenance of the new field at Lions Field, at the new one at Fort Williams. You know, overall, my sense is this budget is very fiscally responsible, and I really do look forward to the continuing review with the Finance Committee of it. I'm really pleased that we're able to do so much, and we're really, you know, on the cusp of being able to accomplish 100% of this with the tax increase of only 28 cents.
Mr. McGovern, perhaps you could tell the citizens of the community about the review process of the budget so that individuals that are interested can attend.
First of all, in about 2 days, the entire budget will be on the town's website, www.capeelizabeth.com. It will be in Acrobat reader format, so you'll have to download that first, but you can look at that and fully review it. So that's first, and it's also available for those that don't have internet access to come in and get a copy of it. That's first. Second, the council this evening would be acknowledging receipt of it, referring it to the Finance Committee. The Finance Committee will be having a series of meetings in April to review the budget.
Which are public.
The dates are posted on the internet. They're also available by calling. It's that week of April 7th. We've avoided school vacation week. The town council will be having a public hearing on the budget on the second Monday in May. Quite frankly, that's a little late to try to impact it. If you have concerns about the budget, the sooner citizens come forward, the better. In May, while it still is possible to change, it's more difficult.
And just so the public at home understands, the Finance Committee is a committee of the whole of the town council. And you know, that is really a place where if you have an issue with the budget, you can talk to town councilors at those committee meetings, and you can, as an individual citizen, have impact on this budget. You just have to take the time and effort to read it and look at it and talk to the town councilors. Councilor Berry.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that the council receive the proposed municipal budget with thanks to all concerned for the fiscal year 2000, and that it be referred to the Finance Committee.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor McGinty. All in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. I would be remiss if I did not thank the town manager for his efforts and all the employees' efforts in putting together this proposed municipal budget. Item 110.
Chairman.
I'm sorry.
On item 110, I would move that this be tabled because I believe that the town clerk needs more information that she's going to gather, and she's requested it, and I think that's reasonable. So I'd move that this item be tabled to the next meeting.
All right, and by this item, you mean the action upon proposed fees for Riverside Cemetery burials and markers?
My very word, Your Honor.
All right. There's been a motion to table item 110. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Watson. All in favor? Motion's tabled to the next meeting.
I apologize for addressing you as Your Honor. I've been in court all day, Judge.
No one's ever going to make me a judge, believe me. Item 111, action to award bid for town center sidewalk and drainage project and provide and accept easements necessary for the project. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, this project has been discussed, reviewed, and analyzed for about 7 years, I think, since it first began. I was extremely pleased to put it out to bid, and I'm extremely pleased that the bid ever so barely came in within the available dollars. What's really good about this is that for mostly funded by federal dollars, we're not only getting sidewalks from Farm Hill Road along Scottsdale Road in front of the schools over here to Jordan Way, the fire station, but we're also getting really significant drainage improvements. The total cost is $505,000 to the contractor, of which roughly 80% is being paid for by federal and state dollars. So it's a real good deal for the town. There will be some new lighting under this proposal, street lighting. I think 24 new trees will be placed along the way. There will be, as I mentioned, great drainage. And at one of your meetings, the last time the council reviewed this extensively, was Billy Jordan was still on the council. And Billy spoke up very, very strongly. Councilor Jordan, I shouldn't be so informal, but we all know Billy, spoke very strenuously about the drainage that runs across the service station lot to the town hall and then floods that lot we were just sort of alluding to next door. The good thing is as a result of Bill's discussion, we approached the state, and this does provide the picking up that water and bringing it into the drainage system, carrying it across the street, going through the drainage treatment area within the school property, and then being discharged to the marsh after that initial settlement. So that's, you know, been, I think, something terrific progress. It's going to be well constructed. It's going to be granite curbs, concrete sidewalks. All of that was as a result of council input over the years. And, you know, we're really pleased that this has come forward. Maureen O'Meara has done an awful lot of work on this over the years, moving it forward. Bob Malley, who's here, Steve Harding, his predecessor as town engineer, has done it, has also had some of the early work on it. Maureen has prepared a draft motion for the council to consider. It's to award the contract to the low bidder, who was, by the way, Mayetta Construction, for $505,935. Maureen has also met with all of the abutters from whom we need temporary easements in order to do some of the sloping on their properties. The next part of the motion is to accept all of those temporary easements. Thirdly, there was an issue with the driveway between the dentist's office, where formerly Dr. McCullum, still owned by Ann McCullum, and the library. That has been worked out so that we would be giving an access easement over the Thomas Moore Library driveway to the Ann McCullum property. The real good benefit of that is we eliminate one of the driveway openings. And Mrs. McCullum, as well as Dr. Dickinson, who plans to buy that property, been fully involved in all those discussions. And we're really pleased with that. Finally, if you may recall, paragraph 4 in what's before you this evening is the state at one point had said we needed to give an easement to them over town property in order to build the sidewalk. It was a little bit crazy. What Maureen has done is to work with the state to come up with, I think, really excellent compromise language. And that is simply we're dedicating the land proposed for sidewalk construction as depicted on the plans for the economic life of the sidewalk, period. If the sidewalk is removed by the town before normal wear and tear renders, the town will replace the sidewalk. So we're only dedicating it for the economic life of the sidewalk. We're not tying the hands way down in the future. So I'm really, really pleased with the way this has come about and want to thank Steve and Bob and especially Maureen O'Meara for all of her efforts. And I think it's a real good bargain for the town to get all that drainage done and to finally enhance the front of Scottsdale Road where the schools are.
Three or four?
It's four. There's one before you this evening that just adds that paragraph so that we're in compliance with the state in terms of dedicating it for the economic life of the
town. So there's four motions, and I would suggest that we can consolidate those into one motion that encompasses all four motions. Yep. And Councillor Reed, since you have probably spent more time on this project than any other member of this council, I assume you would like to make this motion.
There's three motions.
We only have three.
Yeah,
have three.
But the fourth one here
should be in front of your place there.
We didn't have any.
There's the fourth one.
Thank you. I would be very happy to. And it's also nice to know that in 8 years we were still able to do it under budget or at budget.
Second the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that it be ordered that the Town Council awards a bid for the Town Center Sidewalk Drainage Project to Mayetta Construction and authorize the Town Manager to sign a contract with Mayetta Construction in the amount of $505,935.50.
Second.
And that it be ordered that the town council accepts the temporary easements donated by Barbara Johnson, Ann McCollum, Scott Balfour, Gerald and Sharon Murray, Drewitt and Frida Holman as part of the town center sidewalk drainage construction project. And that it be ordered that the town council donates an access easement over the Thomas Memorial Library entrance to Ann McCollum for the benefit of the property located at 2 Scott Dyer Road, and authorizes the town manager to sign the easement as presented. And that it be ordered that the town council dedicates the land proposed for the sidewalk construction for the construction and maintenance of a public sidewalk as depicted on the town center sidewalk project plans for the economic life of the sidewalk. Do you want the parens?
No.
No. Yes, sir.
Is there, Councilor Berry seconds. Discussion. Councilor McGinty.
A question on the bid, maybe Steve can answer this. The highway lighting system, that includes the lighting for the Esplanade or whatever. That includes all the lighting.
Yeah, that's the, I think there's 23 pedestrian lights
right.
that light the walkway along the route.
Further discussion.
Have we chosen the style of those lights? Do we have anything to do with it? Who hasn't already done it? I don't want to get into it. I've already been that.
Council picked them up.
We did that before. Before you joined, we did all that.
I just want to make sure.
And I don't want to do it again.
I don't want to hear it again.
Further discussion. I would like to say that this is a project that is really being funded in large part by federal dollars. Our part of it has been put aside. It's not a new expenditure. It's going to make a big difference in our town. It's really going to make our town center safer, nicer. And I think it's especially with the clearing up our drainage issues, this is a project that we've worked on a long, long time, and it's great to see it come to fruition. And Michael, I congratulate you for staying with this for so many years. Further comment? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? The motion carries 7-0. Item 112, action upon recommendation from Fort Williams Advisory Commission to approve 4 kite fly event days at Fort Williams Park. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Councilor McGinty made that motion. Second?
Second.
Councilor Carson. For discussion?
Just for council reference, you have on your place before you all the events for Fort Williams this summer. And the event, the dates you're approving for the kite fly are the dates that are listed in that master calendar.
So that is correct.
Yep. Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? We unanimously approve the kite fly days. Action 113, item 113, action upon recommendation from the Appointments Committee to fill vacancies on the Community Center Study Committee and to revise the draft charge of the committee. Councillor Reed.
Yes, as my last formal action as the Appointments Committee Chair for the Town Council to consider yet again some wonderful volunteers. We had the position of being having too many people apply to help us with one of our committees, so I'm asking the Council's indulgence in expanding the number of people to serve on this committee by one. Also, the volunteer of the nationally recognized Tennis Coach of the Year has also been appointed by the school board to serve in their membership person's stead. Mark Wilcox has been appointed by the planning board in a workshop they submitted last week. And then we have Ann Swift Kayetta from the Thomas Memorial Library Trustees, Mike Alfiero from the Community Services Advisory Board, Jan Love and Catherine Miller have applied to serve as a member of the general public. And then 2 students have come forward, John Cranshaw and Lindsay Groff. And because of the quality of the applications and the commitment that people have to serving on this committee, which will not last a long time but has a lot of work done, I'm asking with the Councillor Watson and I, who will serve on it, as well as Henry Berry, who's a member of this committee, that the council approve both the list and the change in the number.
And I should say that Lindsay Graff is, in fact, my daughter. I think this is from the Cape Coalition. Quite frankly, I didn't know she was going to do this until I read it. But for the reason, and I will not be on town council when this study committee returns with its work product, but since my daughter is being considered, I will recuse myself.
Is there an economic benefit for you?
I don't even see where you need to in this situation, but
well,
that's up to you.
We don't
need your vote, Councillor.
No. Okay. I move we accept this report as presented by the Appointment Committee with the changes herein.
Second by Councillor Berry.
Did I hear that Councillor Berry should be added to this list?
No, he served on the committee that is putting forward this recommendation.
I misunderstood.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? It's 6-0 with I'm recused. Item 114. Consideration of land offering by Fitzpatrick Associates for a parcel approximately 11,700 square feet in size in the Hemlock Hill subdivision. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, the person at the podium now is Joel Fitzpatrick, the owner of the property. I'd like to point out that this is actually a previously approved subdivision. It had more lots than, it has quite a few lots now. Mr. Fitzpatrick proposed to combine a few lots to make fewer lots. He's also proposing a change in the access, so instead of coming off Hermit Crush, Hemlock Hill, I always get those two confused.
Hemlock Hill,
it's coming out of the Woodcrest area, right? It's quite controversial in the neighborhood, the subdivision, but it is approved, and if Fitzpatrick chose to, he could do it the way that he originally intended. The advantages of doing it this way, which I realize isn't the most popular neighborhood, is that he is reducing the wetland impact to 20% of what it was under the original subdivision. Which is a good change. Secondly, what he's here for this evening is proposing to give a lot to the community that provides some access that he can show you. But I went out and walked it with him, and I always question if these are a good deal for the town. He can explain the details. But after going out there and walking it, it seems to make sense to me. But it looks good. I'm very pleased with what he's offering. So, but he can show you the details of it.
Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Yes, the parcel of land is approximately 11,700 square feet, and it is the first parcel on the right as you're going to be driving in the new road. The existing road is Woodcrest Road here, and this will be the new extension. And this parcel right here is the parcel we would like to dedicate to the town. We would also ask for dedication of the road and the sewer at a future date.
Could you explain the advantage of, as you did when we walked out there?
Yes, well, the Cape Woods condominiums are located to the north of this property. Most of the homes on the Woodcrest area are located in this section here. And it would just act as a nice buffer for this neighborhood. Also, Cape Woods will have a way to, an easement through here to get to this part of the town. Like maybe, for instance, they wanted to walk to Fort Williams or something like that. They could, instead of taking the long way around, they could go through this piece of land. It just acts as a good buffer between the neighborhood and access for Cape Woods condominiums.
It's a connection between two neighborhoods that otherwise the folks would have to walk along Mitchell Road and down over that hill,
exactly,
through the dip onto Oakhurst.
Joel, does my law firm, do we assist you in this at all?
Yes, Walter. Yes.
And I have nothing to do with this. I know nothing about this project whatsoever. But one of my law partners is Mr. Fitzpatrick's attorney. And for that reason, I think it would only be right for me to recuse myself from this matter. And so I would, at this point in time, appoint Penny Carson, temporary chair, to handle this matter, and off we go.
Got it.
I have two questions, if I could ask, through the chair.
Councilor McGinty.
And Mr. Fitzpatrick. First of all, what's the makeup of this land? Is it wet? Is it ledge? I mean, is it passable?
This particular piece of property?
Right.
It's actually, it has a, this little dotted line right here is a stream. Mm-hmm. There is no wetland, actual wetland. These lines here are the RP2 wetlands. This is some RP1 wetland here, also down here. The stream does run through this particular piece of property, but in this area it is dry. There is a sewer easement that goes through here. The sewer line runs this way, down this way, and over to the pump station, which is the town. This is the town piece of property here where there's a pump station, sewer pump station. So there's a sewer easement through here also.
My second question is, on the Cape Woods side of that, the north side of that lot, what does that actually butt up against?
This area here?
Right. What is actually there?
These property lines continue northward, and they have small half-acre, quarter-acre lots for the Woodcrest homeowners. And this is all Cape Woods. There's about a 200-foot buffer of you know, pretty thick woods in between the Cape Woods condominiums and my property.
It does
also here.
But so that is there actual condos on that area just north of this particular lot? Right.
No,
in there?
No. There's probably 300 feet of woods between the condominiums and this piece of property. But the Cape Woods property does abut this.
I guess my bottom line question here is, is it actually feasible for that to be a shortcut, if you will,
sure,
through?
Sure, exactly.
Okay. We're not going to be going through somebody's backyard.
No. They would go. I believe there's already a nice little cleared area right there for if they wanted to. I'm not sure what it's been used for. It's been cleared.
Could you,
Councilor Berry?
Could you identify this gray line toward the bottom there? Is that
this line? Yes. This is Oakhurst Road right here.
Thank you very much.
And this is Mitchell Road, right. Hemlock Hill Road.
Thank you.
Councilor Reed.
Council Chair Pro Tem, could you please tell me, Joel, what are the issues within the neighborhood? I see no members of the neighborhood up here trying to speak and draw our attention to an issue. What are the major concerns?
Well, I don't believe we are here for a public hearing or anything. Tuesday night, this coming Tuesday, I believe it's the 16th, is the public hearing. And I believe there probably will be numerous people there of this Woodcrest area that do oppose this project. Basically, because I guess they just don't want it to happen.
Okay.
Carol.
Where would the sewer connection be, and is that is it appropriate to connect in at that point?
Yeah, you have to.
The sewer runs for the Woodcrest Road area.